It is on. Hi, everybody. My name is Miranda, and I'm the Cat City Kids Director here. And we're starting the service a little bit differently than we normally do because we had an amazing week at Vacation Bible School with Concrete and Cranes. Just wanted to share a little bit of that with you and celebrate all the cool things that God did with all the kids that arrived. We averaged about 35 children every single night, which was super awesome. And Concrete and Cranes was focused around Philippians 1:6, for I am sure of this, that he who started a good work in you will carry it into completion until the day of Christ Jesus. And we learned about God's foundation of faith or love and how we build upon that love all 5 days. I could not have pulled any of this off without my amazing volunteers. So if you helped at all during VBS, any day, any time, will you please stand up so we can just say thanks again one more time? Stand up. I know you don't want to. Stand up. Let's round of applause to everybody who helped. Super great. We're so thankful. So what we wanted to do is we wanted to show off our dance moves. And so our theme song, Concrete and Cranes, was such a fun song that we learned. And we did it every single day, twice a day. And these kids have the moves down amazing. So we're going to share that with you. And then I'm going to take them on back. Come on up. Come on up. Come on, Emery. Come on. Come on. Let's go. Right up here, sweetie. Come on. We're going to perform. You don't want to? Okay. You don't have to. You can just watch. No problem. All right. So kiddos, the screen is going to be right here. I'm going to be down here doing it with you, facing you, but watch right there in case you forget, but most of you know it already. So, all right, let's go. Turn it up.
Please stand with us. We're going to start with a song this evening. As they spoke about their concrete in Christ, we're going to talk about Him being our vision. Same mindset.
You are my vision, the Good evening, everybody. Glad that we're all here. As we do every week, we want to turn to the Lord first as a corporate confessional, that we can all confess to our God together as one body. So let's just take a few minutes to prepare ourselves for that, and then I'll give you the nod and we'll do the confessional. All right, let's confess together as a body. Gracious God, our sins are too heavy to carry, too real to hide, and too deep to undo. Forgive what our lips tremble to name, what our hearts can no longer bear, and what has become for us a consuming fire of judgment. Set us free from a past that we cannot change. Open to us a future in which we can be changed, and grant us grace to grow more and more in your likeness and image through Jesus Christ, the light of the world. Amen.
We're going to do something a little bit different. We're going to leave the confession up, and we're just going to play for a minute and give you time to read back through that a little bit and take some more personal time before we continue in worship.
Oh, Scripture tonight is from Lamentations 3, 22 through 33. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. The Lord is my portion, says my soul. Therefore, I will hope in him. The Lord is good to those who wait for him, to the soul who seeks him. It is good that one should wait quietly for the salvation of the Lord. It is good for a man that he bear the yoke in his youth. Let him sit alone in silence when it is laid on him. Let him put his mouth in the dust. There may yet be hope. Let him give his cheek to the one who strikes, and let him be filled with insults. For the Lord will not cast off forever, but though he cause grief, he will have compassion, according to the abundance of his steadfast love. For he does not afflict from his heart, or grieve the children of men.
Sing it, please. God, we take this time out of our week to gather as your people, to come to adore you, to proclaim the truths of your gospel, that you are great, that you have given us what we don't deserve through your Son, Jesus Christ. And we thank you for your sacrifice and your work and your mercy. Lord, you are a great God, and we praise you today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Well, if you'd join with me in turning to the Gospel of John, chapter 8, if you're on a device, or if you're, some of you have paper Bibles, which is always fun to see. And we're going to have it on the screen up here, and then it's also in your sermon notes. I hope you got a copy of your sermon notes. We're going to move pretty quickly tonight. It's an interesting story. It's a story that gets quoted a lot and talked about a lot when we talk about Scripture. Some of you, you've heard the story. You're familiar with the story. Maybe you didn't remember where it was. You may not remember all the details. I'm going to go ahead and give you a heads up. We're going to work our way through this story because it's a narrative, and especially because of what this story is and because of what this story represents for many of us. And I'm just going to be honest with you. I think a lot of people think they understand this story, but they don't understand it as well as they think they do. So we're going to find out tonight that every word in the story matters. All Scripture is given by inspiration of God, right? Can you guys maybe back me down just a little bit? This microphone's coming in hot. All right, so here we go. John chapter 8, beginning in verse 1. It says, Jesus went to the Mount of Olives, and early in the morning he came again to the temple. All the people came to him, and he sat down and taught them. And the scribes and the Pharisees brought a woman who had been caught in adultery. And placing her in the midst, they said to him, Teacher, this woman has been caught in the act of adultery. Now in the law, Moses commanded us to stone such women. So what do you say? They said this to test him. They might have some charge to bring against him. It's a very curious thing. Jesus bent down and wrote with his finger on the ground. And as they continued to ask him, he stood up and said to them, how many times have we quoted these words, right? Let him who is without sin among you be the first to throw a stone at her. And once more he bent down and wrote on the ground. But when they heard it, they went away one by one, beginning with the older ones, and Jesus was left alone with the woman standing before them. Jesus stood up and said to her, Woman, where are they? Has no one condemned you? She said, No one, Lord. And Jesus said, Neither do I condemn you. Go. And from now on, said no more. You may be seated. May God bless the reading of his word. We are in a series called Judgment Call. And we started week one 2 weeks ago. So this is part two, week three, if you're keeping score at home. This is going to be a four or five week series. It's going to take us a few weeks to get through it because, and I'm going to remind you this at the end, next week we will not be here. We're going to be at a picnic because that fireworks stand is going to be booming. No pun intended. It's going to be July 3rd, and I'm sure the parking lot's going to be full. And so the elders just got together and decided we're going to have a picnic that night. So we'll talk more about that at the end. The series called Judgment Call, really the idea is it okay to judge? And if so, when is it okay to judge? And when is it not okay to judge? And if it is okay to judge, what in the world is that supposed to look like for us? This is a nuanced subject, and I want you to lean into this, and I want you to look at me, because I'm going to give you a little bit of a cultural commentary now. Are you ready for this? This is a nuanced subject, and our culture doesn't do well with nuanced subjects. Some of you already know this, don't you? It's the way our culture's wired. We don't want to think deeply. We don't want to think in long, drawn-out ways. We don't want to think case by case. And yet, this is a very nuanced subject. So what's going to happen for us is going to require for us to do a little bit of a mental workout. We're going to use some muscles that maybe we don't normally use. We don't normally think about using. We don't want to be mean-spirited. We don't want to be hypocrites, certainly. But we do often feel a duty because of our faith to speak out and to speak up. So we told you 2 weeks ago in part one of this series, and this is in your notes, just as a reminder, judgment is a powerful catalyst either for driving people away from truth or drawing people to it. It's going to be a powerful catalyst. In other words, this is the mental imagery that I want you to get in your mind when you think about using powers of judgment and speaking up and speaking out. I want you to think this way. When you speak out, something's going to happen. It's a powerful catalyst. It can catalyze people towards the truth, or it can catalyze people away from the truth. We told you, I gave you kind of this word picture because I think it's useful for us. You really need to think of it like it's a grenade and you've pulled the pin on it. If you pull the pin on a grenade, you need to have a plan. You don't pull the pin on a grenade and then figure out what you're doing. And sometimes, and I'm sure I'm the only person in here that this is true for, sometimes I engage my mouth before I engage my brain. Am I the only one? No, I'm not. Tom said I am. Tom's my friend. We do this, right? And you wouldn't do that with a hand grenade. You wouldn't do it, and you'd be silly if you did. And yet, this is where we find ourselves. We have to be really careful because we understand when you pull the pin on the grenade, you don't need to be careless and you need to have a plan. So 2 weeks ago, in part one, we really talked about the necessary medicine that we need for our proud hearts. And it was medicine. It was a bitter pill to swallow. I commend you. In fact, I commend you for coming back after sitting through it. That was a tough sermon to listen to. It was a tough sermon to preach. I had heard it all week from God because I needed to hear it too. This is all of us. And so tonight we're talking really about how do we move forward when we're right, when we're not being hypocritical, when we're right and they're wrong. How do we speak out? What does that look like? What if you're right and they're wrong? And I know you don't have a hard time imagining this because you imagine it all the time. Because here's what I've heard from my friends and people that I love, people that I trust. These are what I call the shower conversations. You have conversations with people in the shower? You're in the shower, and you just got this scenario going through your head, and you know, when I see them, let me tell you what I'm going to say. You're talking to yourself, right? Let me tell you what I'm going to say, and then they're going to say this, and it's, oh, I'm going to nail them because I've got the perfect, I hope they say it this way, because then I'm going to, right? Of course, none of you do that, but you know people that do, right? You dream it up. It's when you're driving to work by yourself and you've just got the scenario imagined perfectly. Listen, they're right and they're wrong and I'm right, and I've got charts and graphs. I've got slides. I've got a slideshow. Like, I've got it all figured out. How do you move forward? What does that look like? The temptation is for us to be right, but for us to ignore how we are being right. Because here's what I want to say to you. And again, I commend so many of you because this is a difficult subject. We back at Christmas, if you remember, we talked about the Imago Dei. What does it look like to realize that everyone you lock eyes with is made in the image of God, whether you agree with them or not, whether they believe what you believe, whether they share anything, whether you think you don't share anything with them, they are made in the image of God just like you. And since Christmas, I've heard so many of you bring it up. Oh, that's right. I need to remember that. I was reminded of this, that they're made in the image of God and I'm made in the image of God. Well, that principle has to overlay how we interact with people. And some of us just like to be right. Is there anybody else in here that just likes to be right? Yeah, right. Me and her, not the rest of you. Just the two of us. We're here. Listen, we love to be right. But did you know that being right is not the highest and ultimate goal for us? In case you wonder, 1 Timothy 1, verse 3, It's in your notes. Paul says to Timothy, remain at Ephesus, which is where he was pastoring, so that you may charge certain persons, look at me, wink, wink, certain persons, you know who they are and I know who they are. I don't need to tell you the name because we all know the names. So that you may charge certain persons not to teach any different doctrine, nor to devote themselves to myths and endless genealogies which promote speculations, rather than the stewardship of God from God that is by faith. In other words, you monitor when people are wrong and correct them. Why do we do that? Why do we do that? The aim of our charge is what? Some of you already know, right? You're looking at your sermon notes. You know what the next word is. The purpose of being right is not just to be right. It's not so that you can win the argument and the conversation can go down the way that you imagined it would go down. The aim of our charge is love that issues from a pure heart and a good conscience and a sincere faith. What kind of church would we be if in the process of us figuring out what's right and living for what's right and standing for what's right, we made it the aim of our conscience to live in love and to speak love and to be loving? It is possible, this is in your notes, it is possible to be factually correct and spiritually wrong-headed at the same time. I tried every way I could this week to reword that in a way that was smoother, and I just couldn't do it. Wrong-headed is wrong-headed. And I've done it more than quite a few times, right? It's possible to be factually correct and spiritually wrong-headed. And so tonight, we're going to look at the right way to be right. What's the right way to be right? We're going to look at this story that we just read, and so you kind of, I mean, you know how the story ends. We're looking at the story from two perspectives. You've got these spiritual, these kind of religious leaders, and then you have Jesus. Anybody want to guess which one was right? Guess which one we're supposed to be following? So Don Carson, whose commentary on John is phenomenal, says that he thinks this likely took place maybe during the last 2 weeks of Jesus' ministry. That's not where I originally thought this story took place, but I think it fits there. This was maybe at the end of Jesus' ministry. Jesus was spending the nights in Bethany, which is on the eastern slope of the Mount of Olives, which was just right outside Jerusalem, about 2 miles east of Jerusalem. He was spending the nights in Bethany and traveling to and from Jerusalem every day to teach. And he would pause at the Mount of Olives as he was traveling, because this was, he wasn't the only person traveling this path. And so we go back to verse 1. And again, by way of reminder, I need you to enter into the narrative with me, and I need you to really lean into every word, because every word of this story matters. Jesus went to the Mount of Olives, verse 1. Verse 2, early in the morning, he came again to the temple. All the people came to him, and he sat down and taught them. The scribes and the Pharisees brought a woman who had been, what are the next three words? Say it louder. This is not rumors. This is not gossip. This is someone witnessed something happening. You don't need me to tell you that the mechanics of this act is that if you were caught in it, I want you to think about this, and maybe you've never thought about this before. If you were caught in it, you weren't alone. I don't need a chart and a graph to explain that to you, right? That's my question. Where's the guy? Where's the guy? A couple of conjectures, which I think are pretty safe. Either it was a trap specifically intended for her, or it was some sort of good old boys network, and they let him go. So we've got a problem right when we get started. Here's what I want to tell you. Whatever they were after, and I think we know what they were after, they weren't after justice. They weren't seeking righteousness. They were flying in under the guise of seeking righteousness and justice, but they weren't seeking righteousness and justice, because I've told you this before. Justice and righteousness, theologically, those words are interchangeable. You can't seek righteousness in an unrighteous manner. Righteousness comes from God. Can't seek justice in an unjust manner. because God is the source of all righteousness and justice. We must decide in your notes whether our motive is to win an argument or to pursue righteousness. We may want to sit with that one for a little bit, huh? How often is it true for you and I? We've got the verses, we've got the charts, we've got the experts on speed dial, we're ready. And we know that we're right. But really, if we were to be honest with ourselves and honest with God, we would have to admit that our hearts are just after being right. We just want to be right for the sake of being right. So we have a fear that we think is legitimate. I don't know if this is going to resonate with you, but as I thought this week, I put this in the sermon, and then I pulled it out. I put it back in, and I pulled it out, because I don't know if it's just me, but there's something in my heart when I'm trying to be right. There's something in me that's afraid that if I lose some kind of argument, discussion, what, however you're keeping score, you can already hear the wheels coming off of the whole thing, right? How do you win, right? If I lose a discussion or an argument, then God loses. I don't know if anybody else in here struggles with that. Could I just tell you something? And this is a really important theological truth. We're only right when we align ourselves with God. Because God's always right. No matter who else thinks he's right, he's always right. And he never loses. It doesn't matter what kind of discussions you and I have, or who else we have discussions with, or whether we land the, you know, whether we land the point, whether we prove our point, whether we convince anyone or not. Can I just set you free? God doesn't need you to protect him. I don't know if that lands with you, but man, it meant so much to me when I thought through this week. How often am I trying to protect God? I don't realize that's what I'm doing. Can I just tell you? And you know, because we just read the story, and you're familiar with the story. Before this story ends, every sinner is going to be addressed. That's what God does. Isn't it amazing that Jesus is immediately thrust into this situation where there's a ton of conflict? I mean, they just bring conflict to him and drop it right in front of him. And it's a gang. It's not, you know, it's him versus a group. I don't think his blood pressure raised. This is what God does. God's not nervous or upset. In Romans 3, Paul is addressing how the Jews have this inconsistent pursuit of justice. Because in Romans 1, it's all about how creation reveals to us, even to people that we would, you know, maybe we would call them pagan, they would have used the term Gentiles. These are people who are far from God, who don't believe in God. We're still guilty because creation shows us that there's a God. There's enough revelation in creation for us to know that we should be seeking God. And you can almost hear the Jews getting, that's right, Paul, you tell them. You tell those wicked people how wicked they are. Does that sound familiar? You and I in that moment when we're those people, that's right, go get them. Go tell them how wicked we are. They are. We should think to ourselves, uh-oh. Because they're not the only wicked ones. Romans 3:19, Paul says, we know that whatever the law says, it speaks to those who are under the law. Time out. You know, in this context, I know everybody's under the law. But in this context, do you know who was under the law? Jews. In the midst of the Jews going, that's, you get them. You tell them. That's right. We're right and they're wrong. And you just let them have it. And Paul says, wait a second. We know that whatever the law says, it speaks to those who are under the law so that every mouth may be stopped and the whole world may be held accountable to God. When God's ready, the truth comes out. All the time. He won't ask for permission. He won't take a vote. He just does what he wants to do. Aren't you glad? Even though sometimes you and I should kind of be shaking in our boots because we're like, oh man, yeah, I need to remember. I don't need to be so self-righteous. I don't need to be so holier than thou. I need to remember that I'm a sinner before God just like everybody else. And yet, that's the God that we serve. That's the God I want to sing to. That's the God I want my kids coming every night in VBS and hearing about. That's the God of the universe. Such a God is worth us giving our lives to, right? You guys got excited for Greg last week. Come on. Okay. So the scribes and the Pharisees caught this woman who had been, brought a woman who had been caught in adultery. Here we go. And placing her in the midst. This was so degrading. They could have brought this accusation without bringing her physically. They absolutely could have done it. At this point, she was not a person to be loved. She was an argument to be won. May God help us when we see people as arguments to be won rather than people to be loved. That every single person, I know you don't like it. I don't like it either. Because the pride in my heart, when I'm having that shower conversation, man, I'm just ready to nail somebody. Because in my mind, there's a plot line, and I'm the hero, and they're the villain. And yet, they're made in God's image. They're made in the Imago Dei, and that's inconvenient for my pride. Be courageous enough, this is in your notes, to look beyond the label and see the individual. And by the way, they were getting a 2-for-1. Because they get to simultaneously condemn this woman and try to trip up Jesus. Have you guys figured out that it never worked when they tried to trip up Jesus? They were kind of like the Keystone Cops, right? You see it, I've seen this movie before. I know how it ends. You never trip up Jesus. But they were the little engine that could. They just kept trying. It'll eventually work out. But this is what they're doing. They think they're getting a 2-for-1. And she was only useful as a prop for their agenda. I think you and I should be really careful. We should beware of stories where we're always the hero. Because could I just tell you? We're not the hero, but we serve the hero. And when we're aligned with him, that's when we're right. But we're not right because we're smart or because we're holy or because of anything else. We're right because we're aligned with the one who is right. But we're in his shadow. And he's not just right, he's also love. Verse 4, they said to him, "Teacher, this woman has been caught in the act of adultery. Now in the law, Moses commanded us to stone such women." Such women. Such women. The law was never feminine. That's not what the law said. The law said you stone everybody. Never said anything about women. Isn't that interesting how you can just twist it? Just a little bit. The law said this, so what do you say? We should beware of twisting God's truth to fit our agendas. Verse 6, this they said to test him so that they might have some charge to bring against him. Because see, here's the thing. If he said stone her, then he's put himself against the Romans who were the political power in their area at that time. The Romans were the people who were politically in charge. And if he said stone her, he's put himself against the Romans because they reserved capital punishment for themselves. But if he said excuse her, he pits himself against the Jewish law. That was their plan. We've trapped him. There's no good answer for him to give. But along the way, we lost something. Why? In your notes. Because ignoring the Imago Dei and others leads to the loss of their dignity. We don't treat them like they were made in God's image. It's frightening. We should see the sin and the sinner, but we need to see them as fellow sinners because that's what we are. So Jesus bent down and wrote with his finger on the ground. I have no idea what he wrote. I've always wondered. Nobody knows. Some good conjecture. Maybe some verses from the Old Testament law. Maybe he wrote her punishment in the sand. I'm going to ask him one day, what'd you write? Was it her sentence? What did you write? As they continued to ask him, verse 7, by the way, they continued to ask him because they think they have him backed in the corner. They think they've got him. They think that he can't answer. As they continued to ask him, he stood up and said to them, let him who's without sin among you be the first to throw a stone at her. And once more he bent down and wrote on the ground. That's just cold justice, isn't it? I mean, you think you had me, and I'm not even like, oh, that's so cute. He was savage. Two observations. The first one is it's possible, and I did not know this until I read Carson's commentary on this. It's possible that Jesus was talking about specific sin. It got really quiet in here, didn't it? It's possible that he was looking at those religious leaders and saying, let the first one of you that's not guilty of adultery throw stones at her. I don't know. It's possible that that's what he meant. We don't know. That's conjecture. But this is what I can't get over. He could have stoned her. He could have stoned her. Of the whole group, there was one person who was without sin, and it was who? He could have stoned her. And it would have been 100% correct. I just pray that God wrecks you this week with the idea that he's not throwing rocks at you when he can. Even when you're guilty, God's not throwing rocks at you. Do you feel how deep that grace is? How deep that gospel truth is for you and for me? He wasn't saying no one's qualified to stone her. He was saying I'm the only one that's qualified. But after he said it, what did he do? He went back to writing in the sand. Isn't that a fantastic story? He could have stoned her. He could have done it. The only appropriate response to the forgiveness of your sins is to never forget that you also are a forgiven sinner. On your best day, you're a forgiven sinner. On your best day, you're still guilty. I told you this the first night that we met as a church. There'll never be a day that you don't desperately need Jesus Christ in your life. And may we always exist as a church to remind ourselves and to remind each other that there's never going to be a day that we can live without him. God, help us. If there's a day when we try, no, God, I got it. What in the world? Verse 9, when they heard it, they went away one by one. What is this about, beginning with the older ones? What is that about? You know what it's about? They figured it out first. They're wise enough to catch on. Jesus was left alone with the woman standing before him. Those who came with the purpose of shaming Jesus left in shame. Jesus stood up, verse 10, and said to her, woman, where are they? Where'd everybody go while I was writing? You mean after all that hullabaloo, nobody's going to condemn you? I mean, they had the moment. This is the climax of the movie. They were there. They had the evidence. This is a slam dunk if there's ever been a slam dunk. What happened? Where'd they go? Has no one condemned you? And she said, I don't know, you think she was crying when she said it? How did she feel? Her dignity was restored. Her dignity was restored because even in her worst moment, she was still made in God's image. Even in her worst moment, she had value. You know why? Because God decided that she had value. It had nothing to do with performance. God decided that we have value. And he is in the heavens, and he does as he pleases. And he just decided that she had value. I can't imagine for her to say out loud, no, no one. Acknowledging the imago Dei in another person means honoring their value as an image bearer. And Jesus' reply, notice every word, neither do I condemn you. Can you imagine how controversial that was? Seriously, who does he think he is to pardon someone who's guilty of sin? Well, he was God, right? I mean, it's not a trick question, but don't miss it. Don't miss the weight of what was happening. Who do you think you are? He's God. Neither do I condemn you. Go, and from now on, sin no more. Please hear this. Don't miss this. He honored the imago Dei in her while also calling her to a different and better life. He did both. And I'm telling you, the morons on social media will convince you that it's not possible. You know why? Mental laziness. It's difficult. How do you hold to both of those things? I don't know, but you better figure it out because you're an adult. And this is what adults do. Adults do hard things. What does it look like? What if I don't always get it right? I don't know. You better just be praying and asking for the Spirit to be there with you. And then afterwards say, how'd I do, God? How'd I do? You better figure out how to honor the imago Dei in them and still speak truth. You better figure out how to do it. I think we have a pattern here. I think we have somebody modeling it for us. This is difficult, but maturity means embracing the responsibility of doing difficult things and not creating a fool's choice. You know what a fool's choice is? When you're forced to choose between two things when really you were supposed to hang on to both. We don't need fool's choices. You don't need to create artificial ones. You need to do both. Please hear this. When you're forced to choose between being kind to people and being clear about sin, choose both. Choose both. You say, Tim, that kind of makes me feel like I should respond with fear and trembling. Yes, we should. In fact, if you're responding with fear and trembling, you may be doing it right. If you love this person, if you know this person, and you've earned the right to speak into their life, do it with love. But you got to figure out how to do it. Here's the thing that I couldn't get over this week. It's concrete and cranes. Remember? The kids came up here, right? That's cute. That's cute. They had their hard hats, and they had their little badges. And every week, every night of the week, there are four rows of kids here. And it was funny to watch them tonight because they were screaming all week. I don't know why they weren't screaming tonight. They know every word of every song, and they're screaming, and they're jumping around. They're doing the hand motions. I felt like I should tell them, we're Baptist. We're not allowed to dance, right? That's a joke. But here are these kids doing these hand motions. And I kid you not, I stood in the back more than once and dissected what was going on theologically and just cried. And I don't know if they understand what they're singing, but I just hope God lodged a big fat anchor in their hearts this week. And one day the lights are going to come on. And they're going to realize The whole purpose of the whole purpose of the whole week and the whole purpose of that song really was Philippians 1:6. I am sure of this, that he who began a good work in you, he will. All the forces of hell may line up against you. He's not worried. Your friends may forget you and your family may betray you. God's not scared. You may feel like you're in the bottom of the pit, and right now you may be in the bottom of the pit. But I know how the story ends if you belong to him. He who began a good work in you will complete it. And the Greek says he will perfect it. He will bring it to maturity. When it's all said and done, you're going to have everything you're supposed to have. That's how the story ends for you and I. That's what they were singing about this week. They may not have known it, but the concrete and cranes is about God doing this work in us, digging deep to pour this solid foundation. He's going to complete what he started at the day of Jesus Christ. And you know what I thought about? It's not just that he's doing that work in me and he's doing that work in you, but as we interact, he's using us in each other's lives to do that work. And if you don't hear anything else that I say, I want you to look me right in the eye right now. If that's true, if he's using us simultaneously in each other's lives to complete the good work that he started, how important is it that we get this right? And I don't know who you're going to lock eyes with this week. Oh, man. Oh, God, knock them over. I don't know who you're going to lock eyes with this week, that he may be in the middle of doing an important work. And you better steward that opportunity well. You better maintain the imago Dei in them and speak whatever truth he's called you to, which may mean for you to button your lip, depending on how well you know them and what kind of relationship you have with them. But man, oh man, this is such important work. We've got to walk with the Spirit. We've got to remember this promise is real and it's active. And he's not doing it by waving some magic wand over us. He's using us in each other's lives and in the lives of those we interact with. God, help us to know how important this is, how high the stakes are. And yet, all we've really got to do is listen to his Spirit. And you know what? Be loving, and joyful, and peaceful, and patient, and kind, and good, right? And full of faith, and self-controlled, and gentle. That's a pretty good list. Somebody should write that down. We know, as God's Spirit is empowering us, this is what it's going to look like. And it's not going to be natural. It's going to be supernatural. We can't do this naturally, but man, oh man. Let's pray. Oh God, please, please, please. Energize us. Empower us. Move our hearts. Move our feet. Give us wisdom to know when to shut our mouths. I pray that every single thing that we do, every single interaction that we have, that we would hang on to the imago Dei in whoever it is that we're talking to. Whether it's online, in an email, on the phone, in person, text message, whatever it may be. May we never damage the imago Dei in the person that we're interacting with. If we're going to be on your side, help us to act like it. We don't want to act more like the nasty religious people that Jesus chased off. We want to act like Jesus. To speak the truth in love. To speak the truth in love, which may be one of the most profound things that you wrote in your Bible. To speak the truth in love. We don't know how to do that. We're not wise enough to do that by ourselves. But we can daily and hourly depend on your Spirit. We can have the courage to try we can prayerfully and hopefully have the discernment to read the situation that we're in, to know how well we know the person we're interacting with. Because God, most importantly, we want to be partners with you as you're completing your good work in the people that we interact with. Because along the way, as we're doing that well, you're also completing the good work in us. You just keep building concrete and cranes. God, that's what you do. You're just building us up, preparing us for an eternity with you. Guide our hearts, guard our mouths, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Stand with us. There's a reason why the curse of sin is broken. There's a reason why the darkness runs from light. There's a reason why we stand here now forgiven. Jesus is alive. There's a reason why we are not overtaken. There's a reason why we sing on through the night. There's a reason why our hope remains eternal. Jesus is alive. Praise the King, He is risen. Praise the King, He's alive. Praise the King, death defeated.
thanks so much for coming. I don't know what your response is to this subject that we talked about tonight. If your response is not, oh, I got this under control, then that's a good sign. If you walk away going, I need to at least think, I need to reflect, I need to see, that's what we're trying to do here. We want to be kind in addition to being right. Amen? All right, so don't forget next week, because I know somebody's going to message me. I'm going to get an email. It's going to happen. I drove there and you weren't there. And okay, so on 35th, what you're going to be looking for, because I've already been asked, the address is in the bulletin. Yeah, I'm pretty sure it's in there. And so, but these white feather flags that are out by the road, we're going to have those there. So you're going to go along 35th and you're going to be looking for that. It's going to be on the south side of the road, just this side of Button Road on 35th. So you need to bring a chair, you need to bring a side, and a dessert to share. And we're providing the meat and all the other good stuff. If you want to pray with somebody, if you have questions about something that you've heard, or you want to pray with somebody, Danny and Sylvia Woodard are going to be right over here. They'd love to pray with you. I'll be somewhere around here milling around. Come find us and talk to us. I want to do something different tonight for our benediction, because we quoted Philippians 1:6, and Philippians is just my favorite book in the New Testament and probably in the whole Bible. I love the whole Bible, but man, Philippians just gets me going. So I just want to read to you a few of these verses because it is a benediction. I don't need to reword it. This is what Paul was saying. This is what he says. Philippians 1, starting in verse 3, I thank my God in all my remembrance of you, always in every prayer of mine for you all, making my prayer with joy because of your partnership in the gospel from the first day until now. And I am sure of this, that he who began a good work in you will bring it to completion at the day of Christ Jesus. It is right for me to feel this way about you all because I hold you in my heart, for you all are partakers with me of grace. It is my prayer that your love may abound more and more with all knowledge and discernment. Ooh, this is so good. So that you may approve what is excellent. It's my prayer that you would have discernment so that you may approve what is excellent and so be pure and blameless for the day of Christ, filled with the fruit of righteousness that comes through Jesus Christ this week, that we would live to the glory and praise of God. Thanks for coming. Hope you have a great week. You're dismissed.